Thank you for listening to KSO Today, your free daily podcast from K-State Online. We'll talk Kansas State football, basketball, recruiting, and everything going on at KSO, your rivals.com home for Kansas State athletics. This podcast will move rather quickly, so let's not waste any more time in kicking off another installment of KSO Today. It is January 22nd, 2020, another day of KSO Today here on a Wednesday. And let's jump right into this thing. Of course, we are sponsored, as always, by People's State Bank and Legacy Insurance. I always appreciate them, but no big read today. There's a lot to talk about, of course, with what happened in Lawrence, Kansas, Allen Fieldhouse last night at the end of K-State's 81-60 loss to the number 3 ranked Kansas Jayhawks. I was not in attendance last night. Certainly regret it a little bit. We usually get two credentials there. I wanted to let Flando and Logan go, and they did a great job. Their coverage was fantastic. Full Bruce Weber video. I think the first people to have it up on the internet, so I really appreciate them doing that. They were fantastic. I was just a little sad not to be there to witness it and have my own perception, you know, from in the building and said from what I saw. But that's what I'm going to spend a lot of time talking about, is this fight in Lawrence after the game, at the end of that game. I'm going to walk through the whole thing. I've spent some time kind of writing down thoughts on what I saw and just share it with you. Now, before I do this, I'm a Kansas State graduate. I cover Kansas State. I'm around the Kansas State program all the time. So I'm going to have a bias towards K-State, just like a lot of people would have a bias towards Kansas with some of their defenses of the Jayhawks. I'm going to try to be impartial here and just write what I saw, and this is what I believe. But I do want to give that precursor to me listening. Yes, I went to K-State. Yes, I do probably like K-State more than KU, and that may influence this. So let's start with the DeJuan Gordon steal. I don't love Gordon stealing the ball here, but it's a basketball play. He's really played till the whistle, the final whistle, every year, and we've praised him in print and on the show for doing so in other losses. It's something we've talked about more than once, at him diving for loose balls in the final seconds of games. He has constantly played toward the end of the game. This was not a different play from him. Also, I think you have to wonder if he even goes for the steal, if Silvio De Sousa doesn't push him off pretty needlessly with his right forearm to create separation when Gordon is not giving heavy pressure. So if you go back and watch that part of the steal again, just think about that. Gordon, his body language is not pressuring the ball. He is not putting physical pressure on De Sousa, but De Sousa feels the need to take his right forearm, shove him off to create about 2 feet of separation. When he does that, he leaves the ball exposed for probably the easiest steal in the history of basketball, and Gordon chooses to steal it. Whether that's the right choice or not, I don't know. I think in hindsight, he probably shouldn't have because of what ended up happening, but that doesn't mean this was all his fault. He made a basketball play. Other people on both sides of the floor here making non-basketball plays, it doesn't make up for it because a kid stole a ball that you don't like. Now, the Silvio De Sousa block, this more or less is De Sousa doing exactly what Gordon just did to him. We've still got a game playing that is no longer in doubt, but there are seconds left on the clock, and we've got a defensive player playing through the end of the game and blocking a shot. So I have no problem with this either. This is a basketball play. I will say, if you're a KU fan or anybody who doesn't like what DeJuan Gordon did in making a defensive play in a game that's out of hand in the final few seconds, you probably should criticize Silvio De Sousa doing the exact same thing. I have no problem with it. He continued to play basketball. And if a kid steals the ball from me and goes and tries to make a layup, I'm going to try to block his shot too. I have no problem with that. The problem comes after the block. And anybody who doesn't see this and can't acknowledge this, this is where I probably lose the ability to talk with you about the subject. The problem starts when Silvio De Sousa stands above DeJuan Gordon for at least, I'm not exaggerating here, 3 to 5 seconds. I can't quite tell because of all the different videos you watch, it moves around. But it may be 5 seconds of him standing over another grown man. He not only stands over him, he then leans over to talk trash. This is when it all changes. Up to that point, you'd had a few chippy basketball plays, but nothing that would have made a highlight even on, you know, one of our shows, let alone be the lead of SportsCenter. The problem starts with a Kansas player, Silvio De Sousa specifically, stands over a guy and makes this into a big issue. David Sloan rushes in first. From what I've seen, I don't think there should be any penalties for David Sloan. He was already on the floor. I never saw him throw a punch or give a really aggressive shove. He was literally just running over to protect a player who was being stood over and taunted. I'm sure he was aggressive. I'm sure he said some things like anybody would in that situation. I don't see David Sloan doing anything wrong. I'd expect and guess Antonio Gordon is the most severely punished Wildcat. I've watched a dozen or so times, a ton of different angles of this video from fans, from other media, just the TV broadcast. And it's pretty clear that Antonio Gordon gives a very aggressive, pretty strong two-handed shove to the chest of De Sousa. That, I think, really shocks Silvio De Sousa. I think he believes he's just going to be in a yelling match and taunting people. I don't think he believes an actual fight's going to start. And that kind of does, I believe, kick off when he gets a two-handed shove right in his chest for Antonio Gordon, who did come off the bench. So I'd expect likely penalties for Antonio Gordon. I'm not pushing for them, not suggesting what they should be. I don't think he was the worst person in this crowd by any stretch. That was clearly Silvio De Sousa. But he did do that. He did give a two-handed shove, and I think that's going to warrant some penalty as well as coming off the bench. Beyond that, after watching the video all these times, De Sousa is the first player I can find on either team to throw punches, and he throws tons of them, landing at least one on Sloan before James Love and Levi Stockard even come into the picture. Those two, James Love and Levi Stockard, both also left the bench. I initially, you know, just from watching on TV, kind of the fracas of the whole thing, reading Twitter, reading message boards, thought Love had thrown the first punches, but it's actually not even close. I did tweet out, there's so much stuff out there, I know it's going to be hard to find, but I think it was the Barstool KU account had a view from the crowd, and it was, from that view, it was very clear that Silvio De Sousa has probably thrown five punches before James Love's even in the picture. And he does start throwing punches as retaliation for at least one striking David Sloan in the head. So James Love throws punches, no doubt about it, but he wasn't the first, no doubt. De Sousa, interestingly enough, if you watch it, and I'm not trying to glorify a fight because either side can do this and that'd be silly, he literally does turn and run away from James Love as soon as James Love gets in the fracas and starts throwing punches. De Sousa gets separation from Love immediately, then does, you know, really the unbelievable, the whole thing, grabs the stool and looks to attack James Love with it, while two other Jayhawks, I believe starters who came off the bench, I believe it was Marcus Garrett and David McCormick, I could be wrong, but that's what I think I've read and seen on the video, continue to attack Love after he's already on the ground. He's knocked to the ground or pulled to the ground almost immediately. Those two continue to work at attacking him, taunting him, I believe even kicking at him, while De Sousa only doesn't hit him with a stool because a Kansas assistant, I believe, Jarence Howard, comes and takes it from him. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time guessing on penalties for either side, you know, but ultimately I don't know how De Sousa plays another game in Lawrence. He absolutely initiated this entire thing by standing over a player and taunting him for a lengthy period of time, the first non-basketball play in any of this sequence, and he went out of his way to do it and for a lengthy period of time. He's also the one who literally grabbed a weapon from the audience and was going to use it until a KU assistant pulled it from his hands. We can argue about all sorts of other guys, and neither team was faultless. Neither team was innocent in this thing. K-State players did things that they're going to be punished for, and rightfully so. But the things Kansas did in this was a little bit unique. You know, neither side is free of fault here, like I said, to be clear. You know, but only one side went to the point of throwing the first punches, grabbing a weapon, and kicking a down player. That was all Kansas. The biggest gripes people have with K-State are Gordon playing until the game is over, which Kansas then turned on and did itself as well, and a reasonable gripe for Antonio Gordon's two-handed shove. So while both sides were at fault, and I know I'm not trying to backtrack on that and say, but Kansas did worse, the fact of the matter is Kansas did some uniquely bad things in that fight that will stand out. That's why they're all over, you know, ESPN. That's why they're all over Rivals. That's why they're all over the place. You don't see K-State on the front of it. You see Kansas, because they had the player who grabbed a weapon and people who continued to attack and go after a player who was down on the ground. I think what K-State was doing was a post-game fight or just a skirmish that you'd see 100 times. Again, like I said, you would never see on TV anywhere because they're so common. The things Kansas did made it uncommon and has made this into a big story. As for the game itself, I thought Kansas was very impressive, played really, really well. Christian Brown was a big difference after K-State was tied. You know, 7-7, I think, at the first media timeout. He had some big shots, really got them up by, I think, 17 at one point, 26-9. I remember being the big first half lead. The game was essentially even from there. I mean, K-State would fall down by as much as 24, I think, get back as close as 11 at one point. So you take away that stretch, which you can't do, and it's a pretty even basketball game. The fact of the matter is Kansas is a significantly better basketball team. They're playing at home. They're prepared for a K-State team that just hammered West Virginia, and they won. The biggest key to the game, if we're talking basketball just for a second here, you know, KSU underscore fan did a great job of teaching us yesterday how K-State had to win the turnover battle and had to probably turn KU over as many as 25 times, which wouldn't be significantly different from their average. I know it sounds like a crazy number, but it's actually pretty normal. That's certainly not what happened in this game. Kansas took care of the ball pretty well, and K-State really didn't. I believe KU only turned it over like 8 or 9 times. I don't have the stats right in front of me. No, it was 10. Here it is. And some of those may have came late. So they had 10 turnovers on a night when K-State probably needs to force 25 and or 20. But you think about that, that's possible. Let's say K-State forces 10 more and gets 20. Let's say that pulls 5 points even off the board for KU by turning it over 10 more times. That might be conservative and say it puts 5 on the board for K-State. All of a sudden, you know, now you have a 10-point game. So still a loss at that point. But I think if Kansas turns it over at the rate fan was talking about, it may well be a K-State win. That's not to say it was close. It was not. It's really just to praise Fan for knowing what was going to perhaps create the biggest difference in this game, what K-State had to do to stay closer. They weren't able to do it, and they took a big loss in Lawrence. I think that's going to wrap us up for this Wednesday edition of KSO Today at K-State Online. Thanks to People's State Bank. Thank you to Legacy Insurance. I appreciate their sponsorship and their time as well. Hey, thank you for listening, and enjoy your Wednesday.